My name is Phillip Brasher. I'm Editor-in-Chief here at Agri-Pulse. And I have the privilege of moderating our next panel, which you are really going to enjoy. Food is Medicine, New Markets and Health Outcomes from Eating More Fruits, Nuts, and Vegetables. This is a significant issue. Isn't getting a lot of public attention, but it's a significant issue in Washington, D.C., certainly with the Biden administration. And the other place where it is hot and increasing in importance, and I think the country is really watching, is right here in California. And we're going to get to drill down and see what is happening and some of the challenges, a lot of the challenges that you face, because you really are potentially having a significant impact on health outcomes as well as markets, which obviously is the interest of folks in this room. And I think in a very real way, the nation is watching you, and I think the impact is going to be far beyond Sacramento and in California. So to start off, I've asked Andy to kind of lay out what food is medicine and the concept is, and the concepts of medically tailored meals and produce prescriptions. What are we talking about?
Yeah, so there are a few different approaches that are being taken currently in regard to food as medicine. You start with sort of your more pre-prepared medically tailored meals on one end. Those are meals that companies are making and shipping out to patients, and then you've got pre-prepared like grocery boxes or produce boxes, and that's something that Steve is working on, and those are again being mostly shipped out to people. And then you move into something like a food pharmacy, which you may have heard of, where they actually have the produce distribution happening within the healthcare center or within the clinic, and doctors are writing small prescriptions or medical providers and giving those to the patients, and the patient walks downstairs and can pick up a box of healthy food. And then the last sort of more patient-friendly potentially option is like a produce prescription program, where you're giving people, in most cases, like vouchers or cards to take to their local grocer, where they can use it to purchase specifically fresh fruits and vegetables. And those are kind of the different array of options that are out there right now in terms of food as medicine.
Okay, thanks, Andy. We'll drill down into how those work, how those different approaches work, and what we're seeing on the ground and what the challenges are. Next is Katie Ettman. She's a deputy director at Fullwell. You could talk to us about how the reimbursement, how Medicaid and insurance policies are playing into this.
Great. First, thank you, Dr. Luckett, for the good overview of what is food as medicine. I like to start with that, and I'm so glad that that's how we covered this, because it's not where people's minds immediately go. Some people might think of a diet tea they saw on Instagram, or maybe it is a particular juice cleanse. And instead, when we talk about food as medicine, and one of the things I like to prioritize here is this is food to help prevent, reverse, and treat chronic disease. So at a baseline, that's what we're looking at, this real integration of food into healthcare. And then when I say integration of food into healthcare, one of the primary areas that I like to focus on is Medicaid. So for a reminder, or for folks who aren't familiar, Medicaid is our government's health insurance program for low-income folks. Like lots of things in California, we renamed it, so we call it Medi-Cal, but the basic idea here is it's public health insurance. And we are incredibly lucky that we are in a moment in the United States when food as medicine is a building movement. And so there has been lots of movement, not just in California, but in many states, to use something called Medicaid waivers. There's really wonky numbers related to them, but what you need to understand is that these waivers allow states to pilot and test new and innovative ways to provide healthcare. And in multiple states, including California, North Carolina, Massachusetts, Oregon, New York, they are using these federal flexibilities to help patients access food through Medicaid. And so in California, we are doing that through how we renamed our waiver, CalAIM. And so that has allowed health insurance programs. So think of Anthem, Kaiser, those are ones you might be more familiar with. But most counties also have a public plan, so something called San Francisco Health Plan or Alameda Alliance. These are health plans that work with the state to provide Medicaid to individual patients. And each of these different health plans have the option of opting into providing the full spectrum of medically supported food and nutrition, these different food as medicine interventions. And what that means is that a patient can come into a clinic, for example, if their managed care plan has opted in, they might say have diabetes, and they can be given a produce box to help them deal with their diabetes. And the really important aspect of that is that those are Medicaid dollars paying for this food intervention. So a low-income person who might not otherwise be able to access fresh fruits and vegetables can now get them paid for with healthcare dollars. And so in California, that means about 50% of those funds come from the federal government, and about 50% of those are state and local match. And so it is a really intense way to open up the amount of people who have access to these really life-saving, valuable products. So that's one of the key things we're thinking about here is how to use public health insurance to make sure that these are covered for patients.
Okay. Thank you, Katie. Get your questions in and join our discussion on Slido, and we'll get to those in a minute. Next, we're going to start talking, kind of drilling down a little bit and seeing how food as medicine is working in California in several instances. And starting with Santana Diaz, who's the executive chef at UC Davis Health. What's your experience been?
One of the main things that we have the opportunity to do, since we're geographically set up, our hospital here in Sacramento, is support the region, right? And so what we're looking at these opportunities is listening to food as medicine, the programs and the policies that are out there, and can we combine it using the platform of, well, we should just be doing it anyways because it's healthy, and then put a sustainable marker behind it, right? And then source transparency behind that, right? And so in this position, I've been fortunate enough to not have any resistance. UC Davis Health has been they sought after me 6.5 years ago to figure out if they could turn it into a farm-to-hospital program. So at that time, the food as medicine kind of idea was still, you know, it's talked about, but now it's got so much more momentum that we're trying to look at the opportunities, see with CalAIM, and, you know, healthcare providers, the insurance companies that actually can fund the sustainability of the costs, right? We all know that the food that we source locally or even here from California, if you hadn't heard some of the grim realities that we were hearing this morning of the costs and labor and everything else, that's not going away. We have to be talking about value, right? And everything should be value-based. Our health should have value, right? We're either going to pay for this with more expensive food up front, or we're going to pay for it with our health care in the end when we're needing it, right? Either way, the money's being spent. So we've been priding ourselves here at the hospital to say that the value is in the nutrition based on the food that we're providing, which, you know, even though the average stay is about 6.1 days, well, I see that as 18 food intervention opportunities. Right, and as we transition to room service this year, you can still be on whatever said diet you're on out of the 36 that we deal with every day. Even if it's a burger, at least it's like, okay, the best burger that we can provide to you. And then at the same time, as we look at the medically tailored meal opportunity in the outpatient programs, we can be showing them that even if it is a burger or it's a vegan burger that we make in-house, that it can follow you on the way out through the outpatient programs through medically tailored meals.
Steve Brazeel, you were a founder of SunTerra. Talk to us, you work directly with farms as well as actually getting the produce, getting the food to the people who need it. Talk about your experience.
Great, thank you, appreciate it. And Andy and Katie did such a fantastic job, you know, lining out what food is medicine, what food as medicine is, and then kind of the mechanisms behind it and how they're now a covered benefit under, you know, certain states' Medicaid plans. and you know, from Santana and how they actually execute it. So I founded a company called SunTerra Produce in 2000. From 2000 to 2020 to 2020, we were a traditional grower, marketer, and distributor of fresh fruits and vegetables, representing growers mainly out of California, aggregating their volume and selling them to large retail and wholesale accounts. When the pandemic hit, all that changed for us. Our markets disappeared. We were in very significant trouble as a company and as an industry. And one of the USDA's response to that was something called the Farmers to Families Food Box Program. And through that program, we were selected as a contractor. We immediately began working with food banks, community-based organizations, faith-based organizations to get this food out to communities that needed it. And at that moment, we knew right away that everything had changed for us. It changed the way we thought about, you know, our food system and how we wanted to work to better it. So that program lasted after a year. The legacy of that program for me is that it forced us into the room with these partners that we may have never collaborated with and got us working together. So when that program ended, we continued working together with these farmers to bring that food to food banks and have been successful in delivering over 100 million pounds in partnership with those awesome organizations. And the reason why I share all that background is that is how we got involved in the medically tailored meal program. Because of our work with these nonprofits and because of our ability to execute and work together with farmers to bring an awesome, fresh selection of fresh fruits and vegetables to their members, we were approached by a Medi-Cal plan about executing this food as medicine benefit that Katie mentioned. And so we contracted with one Medi-Cal plan, another, and we're currently delivering in 15 different counties in California. Our particular intervention, and Andy did a good job explaining the various different types of interventions, frozen meals versus prepared meals versus a grocery box versus an exclusively fresh fruit and vegetable box. Our box contains exclusively fresh fruits and vegetables that are built to meet that member's specific healthcare needs. And so we really are excited to partner with growers on this initiative. Farmers, local communities get a chance to participate and have a seat at the table when it comes to the healthcare costs that impact all of us. And so we were at a produce convention last week and went around talking to some different growers about some products we want to integrate into the box and really saw some tremendous reception from the industry, kind of that light bulb moment of realizing that, you know, our products can be the answer to some of these healthcare challenges.
Thanks, Steve. Andy, I want to come back to you to have a chance to talk about your experience, because you've been very involved. You are director of a community health center. Talk about your experience.
So we at One Community Health here in Sacramento, which is a federally qualified health center, ran a year-long produce prescription program in conjunction with a team from the Yale School of Public Health and Wholesome Wave, which is a national nonprofit working to address nutrition insecurity. And as part of the program, patients got about $50 a month loaded onto a gift card that they could take to any Walmart of their choice, and they could spend it solely on fresh fruits and vegetables. We did this over 8 months per patient. Not all patients actually took up all of the dollars, which was surprising, but you know, it was during the pandemic, so it was a little difficult. But on average, $36 a month each patient took up for about 200 patients. And we saw a decrease in A1C of about 0.5, which if you're thinking in comparison to what a medicine can do, like an oral pill, it's kind of equivalent to some of our more basic medicines. And then if you're comparing it in price to some of your more expensive medicines you may have heard about in the news, Ozempic, Trulicity, Victoza, those are thousands of dollars oftentimes. So that was $36 a month that we were able to get this done and make these kind of changes with people's health. And not only that, you know, people reported overall reduction in their actual food security status or food insecurity status, and then we also saw that they were reporting overall in their own experience that they felt healthier. You know, people were less stressed. They felt proud that they were able to go to the grocery and be able to buy fresh fruits and vegetables. These are people on fixed incomes who generally have to make choices and where they put their dollars. And in this case, they didn't have to make that choice. And so when we talk about food as medicine, I think it's important to think, okay, this is excellent in terms of what it can do for health, because you're talking about not just A1C for a diabetic, but you're talking about blood pressure, and you're talking about reducing risk for various types of cancers. You're talking about reduced risk for heart disease. Food has the ability to address so many different disease processes, because we know how effective it can be and how low cost it can be. I mean, some of these programs that are now being covered by Medi-Cal are spending almost twice that per month as what we did in our program. So imagine what kind of benefit they can have if we were able to get, you know, like I said, almost a half a point in their A1C on a shoestring in a dream.
Andy, to follow up on that, you obviously have some great results from this this trial. How likelihood is it that you can replicate that on a larger basis that will be needed to prove to insurance companies, to prove to the federal government, CMS, that Medicare,
that work is
that private insurance should cover this as well?
Sure. I think it's a difficult thing to quantitate because there's so many variables that go into what kind of food choices people are making, but definitely the work is being done. They put out a big study from Tufts earlier this year that had similar reductions in A1C across multiple sites, and it's ongoing. The research is ongoing, but it's definitely something that has shown significant promise. I think the main issue at the heart of this is figuring out, you know, quote unquote, from medicine, we talk about a medicine's got a certain dose. Well, what's the right dose of food, right, of healthy food? In my mind, it's like whatever you can get to someone, because the people that I work with on a daily basis, like, they were extremely grateful for $50 a month, and it was life-changing while they were part of it. And the kind of study we did was small, and it was not as intensive. If more resources were put towards doing these kind of studies, I think you could see some really significant outcomes that could change the ways CMS looks at approving this in terms of insurance coverage.
Continuing that discussion of reimbursement and covering the cost, Katie, can you talk about what's happening in the California legislature? These waivers now are temporary.
Correct.
These are pilot program. Talk about what you're working on.
Yeah, took the words right out of my mouth. So I chatted a little bit about how these programs are happening through waivers. In California, we call it CalAIM. The other thing to note about them is they are only for 5 years, which when you say 5 years, you're like, that's a long time. And then I think about the pandemic, and I'm like, time is fake, and that is so fast. And so you have to be thinking about the long-term vision here. And so I actually think what we have represented on the stage is a perfect encapsulation of where we need to go with food as medicine. So as we look to the program that Dr. Luckett ran, we think about that as philanthropically funded. So it was time-bound, it had research that went into it, and is deeply important to building the science and the relationships of these programs. I like to think of that as like level A, like build the foundation. And then we have CalAIM, sort of level B. And so that's what's happening with SunTerra. They have gotten contracts with managed care plans, aka health plans in California. They are being reimbursed through Medicaid dollars. They're reaching more patients. So we're like, okay, we're continuing to build the science. We're actually setting up the infrastructure. But in order to get to C, to sort of that pinnacle of the triangle, you have to think about the long-term viability of these different services. And so right now in the California State Legislature, myself as Fullwell, as well as a co-sponsor, the Food as Medicine Collaborative out of the San Francisco Bay Area, in collaboration with Assemblymember Mia Bonta, are running a bill. It's It's called Assembly Bill 1975. For any of you who do policy in the audience, just like jot that down for me, we can talk about it. And what that bill will do is it will actually transition these pilot services in CalAIM to permanent benefits in Medicaid, so that at the end of December 2026, these don't go poof. We don't stop paying for these important services for patients. And so we, as we talk about the food as medicine movement, this would make California the first state in the country to do so. So thinking sort of into the future. And so there's a lot to be said about pushing for this now. We know that there is federal momentum. There was a large anti-hunger national conference more than a year ago. And we want to make sure that while the opportunity is hot, while that window is open for us to move, we do so. And so right now, that bill has made it into its second house here in California, which means we're, I wouldn't quite go halfway there. But as you all know, there is probably, as you all probably know, there's a big budget deficit in California this year. And so we are thinking about all of the ways that we can make it possible to talk about these interventions as not only impacting individuals' health, but also in some instances being the same price or cheaper than healthcare and long-term potential cost savings. And so we like to think of like an apple a day keeps the doctor away. As we think about how do we actually transition these to permanent, and how do we do that in California with the idea that hopefully other states will follow our lead.
Santana and Steve, I'd like to ask you about your challenges, a couple of challenges. Steve, while we're on the subject of Medicaid insurance, what has been your experience of working with these plans in terms of lining up? You work in, I believe you said, 15 counties now. What kind of opportunity and barriers have you run into?
Yeah, it's been quite a challenge. So California has 58 counties, and each of those counties runs their Medi-Cal program differently. And there are oftentimes multiple managed care plans within a county. And so for us, as we look at this opportunity to work across these 58 counties, it's how do we, you know, navigate that myriad of contracts that's necessary to execute this? So it involves a very long process of getting in touch with those organizations, showing your competency, and then eventually getting to a contract. So and there's also a lot of there are some inconsistencies across the program. So again, each managed care plan, voluntarily implements these community supports in a way that they see fit, and some are different than others. So the type of outreach and the type of program we might be running in one county might be drastically different than the county that's right next door. And so, you know, as these programs grow and as the evidence builds, I think that there's best practices that we'll learn and that we'll understand and kind of, you know, allow these programs to build and become more efficient. Mm-hmm.
Santana, if you can talk about the, we have not talked a lot about the patients. Andy talked a little bit about directly, but we've been pretty high level. How do you, what kind of foods, what kind of produce do you, is well, you how, provide how the most? And you have a very diverse population, obviously, in California, too. And how do you address that and the different tastes?
Definitely. I think that we all can, are touched by a hospital in some way, right? Whether it's how we came into this earth, how we're going out, a family member, tragedy, a celebration of life, someone else, right? We're touched by a hospital, but I think all hospitals, or we can all attest to some magnitude that the food hasn't been that great. Whatever they offer, you know, is not that great. It may be the most nutritious, right? So as we hear these things, oh, it could be the most nutritious, all vegetarian or all vegan or all plant-based, or, oh, it has the right amount of beef, it has the right amount of pork, whatever, right? But what we're not talking about here is, does it taste good, right? Like, that's the problem, right? And so, like, the connection between a culinary eye and dietitians is becoming more evident that it was needed in the medical field, right? So it's like, it doesn't matter that all this information that was input into a system that all hospitals use, that say it contains all the magnesium that this particular patient on this diet needs, but the whole plate is beige, right? And it's bland because on top of that, it's a low sodium diet. And here all the while, we're serving a meal to someone that needs the nutrients to get to heal, to get better, And they're calling their family and friends that are coming to visit and say, hey, can you bring me the local fast food thing, or bring me some more things that are, you know, you that basically put you in the hospital in the first place. I mean, is anybody questioning the fact that this seems a little broken, right? I mean, it's a problem. So taking all this information and working with the dietitians has become very important, right? And as we look at culturally appropriate meals at the same time, right? You give a produce box, and this is where the social determinants of health and all kinds of things come into play. Like, these are great ideas, right, and great things. Wholesome Wave, phenomenal. Chef Michelle Nishan with his program, and, you know, I think is awesome. And trying to figure out how do we integrate it on our scale. An institution like a hospital has something that, with my experience in food, is far different than any other institution I've worked for. And so whether that's sports, call it football, baseball, so NFL, MLB, NBA, it doesn't matter, right? They're all seasonal. A hospital never closes. And if they do, we got a bigger problem. So if we can, as an institution, secure and forecast with these farmers and vet these you know, medically tailored meal programs or using food as medicine, that tastes good, providing recipes, start it with while they're in our care, give them a package as it goes out through outpatient. That's how you impact behavior. We're not gonna impact behavior in 6 days. I don't know anybody that's gonna change their habits in 6 days, so myself included, right? But it's just an opportunity to show that it is a starting point, and at a 646 licensed bed facility, we're not small. And so if we can start it somewhere, in this case, a hospital, with all the bureaucracy and red tape, you can actually implement it anywhere.
We have a question about how are farmers involved in this movement. Steve, as you've talked about, you deal directly with farmers, and I'd also like to, Katie, bring you in on terms of the from the policy perspective, how agriculture is involved in that or can be. But Steve, what has been your experience? What are the challenges in procuring the food, produce?
We've been in the fresh fruit and vegetable supply chain for my entire life, and so like we kind of think about the produce part as the easy part. You know, other folks are always looking at it as the most difficult part. But one of the things that we learned during that pandemic was how to work with farmers to identify the items that the hard to sell items, work to bring revenue to those farmers if they would otherwise leave that in the field, and really kind of focus on that aspect of that. And so once we started receiving consistent volume through these programs, then we're able to be proactive and partner together with farmers to, again, kind of target those hard to sell items and allow them to monetize those, which is an awesome opportunity. With some of the very small farmers we work with, we can represent a significant volume for them. And when they have that offtake agreement that allows them to either expand their operations or feel comfortable that what they're going to grow has a home. And that's whether or not that's part of our food banking program or the fresh fruits and vegetables we use through the through our medically tailored meal program. So we really see this as a local to local solution. When we're working in a county, we're utilizing the products that grow in that county when they're in season. And we really see that excitement of a lot of these folks who don't have access to these fresh fruits and vegetables, getting a chance to enjoy them and impact their dietary choices over time and have them become customers for the farmers in the room.
How do you match, Steve, what Santana's patients or Andy's patients want and need to what your farmers have available.
Right.
And that's
right. And it kind of goes along, there's some questions about registered dietitians. So all of our boxes are designed by a team of registered dietitians who decides what items are best for that particular patient, for their particular health conditions. And then so our job as produce experts is to match that with the hundreds of items that are out there and available at any one given time. And so, you know, our box is a targeted health intervention. So when the RDN suggests a certain roster of fresh fruits and vegetables, it's our job to go find it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Katie, how's agriculture involved or could be involved? What kind of response have you gotten, support have you gotten?
Yeah, so I would say, well, think about this similarly in the two phases. So as Calium exists right now, I mean, you are hearing directly about distributor helping get farmers directly delivered boxes of food to patients. So in that way, there's just automatically a new and different market than there has been in the past just through this Medicaid waiver. And I will say what's interesting about this, and it is both a problem because it means you might have to contract with a whole lot of different health plans and they all have their own intricacies, but also provides an opportunity, is that a health plan in a particular region might decide that they have particular interest in supporting their local agriculture or supporting California agriculture, or someone in the Salinas Valley who's like, oh no, we definitely need strawberries in these boxes during this season, or these are the particular leafy greens. And so I think there is a real opportunity in this moment to look at who is the health plan, also known as a managed care plan in this region, and what are their priorities, and what do we have around us that makes sense that we can aggregate and distribute, or even as you look towards something like a produce voucher, so a produce prescription, fruit and vegetable vouchers, oftentimes what we see, they are limited spend cards, and so even if the individual gets to go into the grocery store of their choice, whether that be a big box store, a corner store, a farmer's market, that money is still flowing back to our farming community. And so I think one of the things we figure out about here sometimes is that, yes, we are talking about health conditions, but often the patients we are targeting are also low income, and so you are just increasing their purchasing power. So there is more money flowing through the system that can support our retailers and our agricultural producers, et cetera. So in the pilot phase, there are real opportunities to start networking with those different plans. And then in the future, as we look towards AB 1975, one of the things that we've built into that bill is an advisory work group to help come up with the rules and regulations that will sort of manage the benefit once it starts to exist. And on that group, we have left a seat for the agricultural community, as well as people to represent actual Medi-Cal recipients, as well as program providers, so that the experiences of those providing these services and accessing these services are represented in those regulations. And so we want to make sure that we're making sure that we're sort of like ground truthing what is about to happen, because we know it's not always easy. And so that is another way to make sure that that voice is heard. So hopefully when that moves forward, there will also be that work group that people can engage with, which will also include public comment for additional folks who don't sit on the advisory work group.
Okay, thank you. Andy, we have a question. Was there any tracking on what food products were purchased out of the $36 a month? And along with that, how do you, in terms of what, I don't know what you know, that's one question, what do you know about what kind of foods were purchased, what kind of produce was purchased? The other question is sort of a longer question. How do you change, how difficult is it to change dietary and change selection, get people to make long-term changes in their diet and to continue making the purchases that they were doing with the $36 a month?
Yeah, the honest answer is I don't know about the actual products that were purchased. I think that data was collected by the funding partner, Wholesome Wave, but I don't have that information. In regard to making lifestyle changes, you know, it's the majority of these patients were already on SNAP benefits. Right, and so this was an opportunity that they had where they were able to take the funds that were given to them and spend it specifically and only directed towards fresh produce. And so I think that just having that sort of awareness, at least in sort of our follow-up surveys with patients, that this money, I can feel free to spend it all on this healthy food, was able to give them a kind of freedom to make those healthy choices. And when it comes to who we found, you know, was our biggest utilizers, who did spend all $50 every month, it was people who had families. And it's because They're wanting to make those healthy choices not just for themselves, but for everyone else in their household. And so I think that's a big part of making lifestyle change, is that I hesitate to say all, but a vast majority of these people would love to be able to spend this money every month, right? And would love to make those kind of lifestyle changes. It's just not in their budget to do so, unfortunately.
Santana, you obviously see your patients for a short period of time, hopefully, but what's your view on how you can change?
I think what you're patterns, hearing and everybody's hearing is that it's habits are difficult to change. Behavior, you know, if anybody had the magic carrot, I won't say magic pill, but magic carrot to give to somebody to figure this out, that'd be great. You're trying to hit it from a multitude of angles. So one of the things that we've been able to do and introduce at UC Davis Health was a new spice line. You can get spices, seasonings at your local grocery store, but if you really look at and pick up the ingredients or read the ingredients that are in those, I mean, they're just loaded with sodium, right? Part of the problem why somebody's in our care, or what I call the hotel that I never want to see anybody at, that plenty of people visit, right? Unfortunately, this is the reality. So what we've done is created a spice line, which is the flavor profile of UC Davis Health, and eventually would like to incorporate that into, is it they receive this at a discharge, right? Here's your six pack of spices that do not have salt, right? And so you add the salt to your taste and to your diet, right, which is appropriate, right, versus something that's controlled of a garlic salt, per se, that you get at your local grocery store that you season and everything with. Anyways, the point is like there's a multitude of ways, you know, whether it's our bedside touching that I'm trying to integrate at the hospital, right? So as a chef, one of the things that you miss when you have the server in between you, the person at a table, is maybe some misinformation. Hey, how did table 64 like their steak? Or why, you know, when all of a sudden you look, the server says, oh, everything was great. And then you look as a chef and you see half the plate not eaten and getting thrown away. And you're like, obviously something was wrong. How do you figure out the answer of what was wrong? The chef goes to visit your table. Hey, how was everything? And that's when you get the right answer. Oh, it was too spicy. Oh, the food was cold. Oh, all the negativity, the good, the bad, the ugly. So we're trying to integrate that as a bedside touch at the hospital. So even though there's, again, like I mentioned, 646 beds, can't touch everybody every day, but if I can do a rotation with all of our chefs to really get that feedback, how was that meal? Oh, it was very bland. Okay, well, according to your diet, this, and just re-educate and reiterate on it, but at least explain too and educate them. Oh, did you realize the asparagus right now, since it's in season, is coming from Yolo County, one of the six counties that touch this hospital or this Sacramento County region, and pass on that education. And oh, at least did you like the flavor profile of it, right? Oh yeah, just needed a little bit more salt. Great, that's using our grilling spice. And you know, we'll be able to give that to you upon discharge and put UC Davis Health in the cupboard, right, in your home. That impacts behavior, right? So there's a lot of different ways to try to do this. I'm sure, you know, I don't know why I haven't seen it before, right? And maybe it's just been muted. Maybe it's at different levels. I don't know. But I genuinely care. I think at health professionals, we care. We look at what's going on in D.C. with opportunities. H.R. 6780 is introduced to the floor for 20 hospital pilot system, you know, to try to further integrate these opportunities and education into healthcare.
Yeah. A lot of learning how to eat well is learning how to cook it.
Right, and then letting the farmers know, to touch on your question earlier, and I think it was one that was asked, was like, you know, are we working with farmers? Yes, directly. We work with 400 farmers. Our program works with 400 farmers across California. You know, and not that we don't want to work out of state. It's just like, why look outside of the state when California is the number one agricultural producing state of our country, right? So from cattle to hogs, which is getting difficult, but all of our produce. And so when you talk about asparagus, I just touch on it now, right? It's like, so asparagus, it grows here in Yolo, so why purchase it all from Mexico, right? And then, you know, it's just all these different things But to touch on the gift card, it doesn't matter if the person's purchasing the fresh produce from Walmart as long as they're consuming the nutrient density of that produce. Yes, we can say and have these arguments here in California, but like we can't ignore like the other states in this country too. Healthcare is all over.
Thanks. Steve, we had a couple questions. One is about tree nuts, whether they qualify. The other question is how farmers are incentivized to participate in these programs. Could you address that? What do you have to pay in terms of incentives?
For the first part, tree nuts, definitely. One of the protein items that we're looking at integrating into the box. If there are any tree nut growers in here, reach out to me separately. And in terms of how growers are participating, we're going out and purchasing items from these farmers to be utilized as components of our box. So under this particular program, there's no incentive. It's just a market purchase. We work together with growers to take a look at what's coming down downstream in terms of their crop availability, and then come to an agreement with them to purchase it. But through one of the other programs we're running called Elevated Foods, we are in partnership with USDA on a grant program they called Partnerships for Climate Smart Commodities. And through that program, we're working with growers across the U.S., but with an intense focus on California, helping them more rapidly adopt new sustainable and regenerative practices. And through that program, we are providing significant incentives to growers to help open up new markets for climate smart commodities that then we will then use as the components for our food as medicine boxes.
Okay, thank you. Just real quickly to wrap up, 30 seconds, what's your biggest challenge? Starting with you, Andy, I'll go down here. What's the biggest challenge that you face in terms of seeing this ramp up, scale up?
I think it's on sort of boots on the ground level is about awareness and making sure that, you know, the CalAIM has been going on for a couple of years now, but how many of our healthcare providers actually knew that they could send these referrals? Like it just wasn't really publicized as well as I would have hoped. And so for the future, hopefully that will be a targeted audience that we can make more aware of what kind of excellent resources are available for these patients already covered by their insurance.
Katie, 30 seconds.
Yeah, I feel like we have all of the building blocks here. We have incredible physicians who want other people to know about these. We have program providers. We have people working in hospitals who want to make sure we see dietary change. We have so much research. I'm gonna throw out one of my favorite stats. A research study in San Francisco showed that by providing a produce prescription, so dollars to go out and buy their own free fruits and vegetables, we actually, to pregnant people, we saw a 37% reduction in the rates of preterm birth. That is a like wild number when you think about that. And that is obviously the health of the pregnant person, that is the health of the baby, and then that is the cost to the healthcare system. So we know it works. We know we have the right partners in the room. We really need the political will to continue pushing this forward. And I think that's what's exciting about the Food as Medicine movement is it doesn't just have to be about healthcare or community-based organizations or for-profit entities or agriculture. It can actually be about all of us pushing for something that helps individual patients in our communities at large.
Santana?
Education. It's just not whatever's cheapest is best, right? Or else we end up in this unfortunate situation that we're in. And so voting with your wallet when you can on the foods that you purchase is important, fresh fruits and vegetables.
Okay.
So the two biggest challenges here, I'll echo Andy's sentiments about awareness. So if you're from California, you work in the healthcare system, learn more about the medically tailored meal program. And then secondly, and I saw it was a question that was asked often, which was the outcomes, right? How do we prove that this is a financially, the math has to work at the end of the day for these programs to sustain over time. So I think, some preliminary studies are coming through, but once we start getting those more robust studies that indicate that not only is this good for community health, but it also saves healthcare dollars, that makes a very strong case for the food as medicine intervention.
very important note to end on. Join me in thanking this panel.